everybody, please welcome Congressman Bob Beaupre.
How are you, Colorado? All right, because I'm out here, that's a sign that we're just about there. I wish you could see what I see. This is the most incredible sight. What a tribute to Colorado. What a tribute to Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan. 44 days from right now, we could call them President-elect Mitt Romney and Vice President-elect Paul Ryan. And the next morning, it'll be morning in America again. Anybody out there, I've got a couple questions for you. Anybody out there in the middle class? You've heard middle class? You know, we've got a president right now that says he's taking care of all of you. How's it working out? Now, to be fair, he did inherit a tough situation. But he said, you know, give me $831 billion. I'll call it a stimulus, and I know it's going to fix everything. It's going to get unemployment down to 5.5%. It's going to create all these jobs, and all these wonderful things are going to happen, and the good times will be here again. You know, yeah, it didn't quite work. I went and I looked. Do you know, ladies and gentlemen, listen closely. Do you know that jobs in America, the total number of people with jobs in America, has been lower every single month of his presidency than that month that he took over? There are fewer employed people in America today than there were in January 2009, and there are almost 9 million more people age eligible for the workforce. Does that sound like progress to you? Does that sound like looking after the middle class to you? Do you know that, ladies and gentlemen, today in America, there are 495,000 more unemployed people than there were the day he took over? Does that sound like looking after America to you? There are 811,000 people that are long-term unemployed in America today. Is that looking after the middle class? There are more than a million more people than when he took over that tell the government, I'd really like to find a job, but I simply can't do it. Not in Barack Obama's America. Does that sound like looking after the middle class to you? But he said he was going to take care of your health care. So he called it, I don't know if he called it, but we call it Obamacare. And he told us, among many, many other things, that in Obamacare, your health insurance premiums would go down by $2,500. Unfortunately, for all of us, and for him, I hope, 44 days from now, the Congressional Budget Office has done a little bit of calculation. They tell us health insurance premiums are actually going to go up by $2,400. Now, $2,500 plus $2,400, that's $4,900 difference, the wrong direction for American families. Is that looking after the middle class to you? And he told us that if you make under $250,000, your taxes won't go up. Not one dime. Obamacare alone has 20 new taxes in it. Forbes magazine says 7 of them, right to the heart of the middle class. And you know the other 13 are going to get passed on to you. in higher wages or higher premiums, higher cost of health care. Does that sound like he's looking after the middle class to you? My friend Steve Forbes called this the most anti-oil and gas administration in American history. Steve Forbes was right. It is. And we're paying the price. Now, he won't tell you when you go fill up your vehicle. I filled up my pickup today. And I practically had to call the bank and get a loan. He won't call it a tax. But when you increase the price of energy on us, out of his policies, it works exactly like a tax, doesn't it? You got less in your pocket. He told us that under his plan, energy prices would necessarily skyrocket. Unfortunately, that's one place he was right. They have, and we're paying through the nose for it, and I don't like it. Gas is up $2.04 today, up $2.04 a gallon from when he took office, and it's there largely on purpose. Maybe not every penny, but he is the guy who said he wanted to drive energy prices up to the level of Europe. We're going to talk a little more about Europe in a minute. You know what it costs the average driver in America because of this $2.04 increase? Average drivers, not me, because I drive about three times as much as the average. Average driver, about $1,400 a year increase expense. Does that sound like taking care of the middle class to you? Not to me either. Not to me either. You know, on his watch, family wages have gone down, family income is down, every household, and net worth of the average family, this is according to the Federal Reserve, is down 40%. On average, ladies and gentlemen, that's $41,000 hit to the American family. Is all of that his fault? No, but you know what is? The fact that still, right now, it's still going down. When are we going to start this recovery? Is that helping the middle class? No, it's not helping the middle class. And you know what else is not helping the middle class? I see some young people here tonight. Every single man, woman, child, newborn infant in America has $15,000 more share of the federal debt to push uphill, just created on his watch when he said, no, I'm going to have the deficit. I'm going to get this debt under control. It hasn't worked, ladies and gentlemen. Has he helped the middle class?
No.
Has he failed?
Yes.
And do we need a new president named Mitt Romney? Ladies and gentlemen, I want to share a thought or two. I want to share just a very personal thought or two about Mitt and Ann Romney with you. Paul Ryan, for that matter. Let me start with Paul. I had the privilege of serving with Paul Ryan in Congress on the Ways and Means Committee. This isn't just a good man. It's a brilliant man. It's a solutions-oriented man. This is a man much like Jack Kemp and Bill Bennett, some of his mentors, some of the people he looked up to. You might think about our current president and what you know about the people he looked up to. I'll take people like Bill Bennett and Jack Kemp. Those were the mentors for Paul Ryan. This is a solutions-oriented man. He's not interested in status quo. He's interested in saving this great American experiment, reinvigorating our free enterprise system, get this economy going again, and making America, as Mitt Romney says, the greatest hope of the earth. A word about Mitt Romney and Ann. I had the privilege of getting to know them very well about 6 years ago. I got to travel with them in the Winnebago in Iowa in January. Believe me, when you're going down the
highway about 55 miles an hour in Iowa in January, you got a lot of window time. I feel extremely privileged to have gotten to know them that way. My wife and I have been to their home. We have seen these people up close and personal. These are good people, ladies and gentlemen. These are good people. These are people that know how to love each other, how to raise a family upright and justly in God's way. And by the way, I don't know if you've looked off that way, but that's pretty inspiring tonight too, isn't it? But Mitt and Ann Romney have been the kind of people, yeah, that might be somebody we know. The kind of Mitt and Ann Romney are the kind of people that we can look up to, we can admire, we can say, that's my first family and I'm proud of it. There is a word that's not used nearly often enough in politics. And if I might, I'll tell you that word is decency. When you're around Mitt and Ann Romney, you can't help but think of that word. The decency of the man. The decency of the man. And more than that, Mitt Romney believes in the decency in each and every one of you. He knows whose image and likeness you're created in. He knows the worth of the American people. He believes in the greatness of this country, and it's the greatness of this country that he is dedicated to elevating once again. This will not be a president. This will not be a president that apologizes for the greatness of America. He will elevate the greatness of America. This is not a president who believes in phony stimuluses that only add to the debt and grow the size of government. This will be a president who understands that the greatest stimulus for mankind is embodied in one word. Freedom! Give us freedom! Ladies and gentlemen, in just a few short moments, as you might have guessed, the man of the hour is going to be here. In the meantime, if I might, ask you to look to that screen, and you're going to get a very short video about a very great man, I hope, and I believe with all my heart, the man who will be the next president of the United States. God bless each and every one of you.
To walk along the lonely street of dreams.
Am I on? Yeah, now I'm on. Welcome to Live Politics. This time it's real. Let me tell you the video you're about to see. This is one that was first debuted at the RNC convention, the Republican National Convention, in Tampa. And if you've got a tissue, if you've got a handkerchief, you might want to keep it close by. This is very, very touching. And then I promise, Mitt Romney will be here. Cue the video.
I'm a guy who believes in the vision of the founding fathers. I believe this is the land of opportunity. I believe that if we restore the principle of opportunity and hope and give everyone a fair chance, you're going to see this country come roaring back.
Never predict what kind of tough decisions are going to come in front of a president's desk. And if you really want to know how a person will operate, look at how they've lived their life.
They were asking me about what's going on with, you know, with what happened with the scandal and what my opinion is of if we can pull this thing off. And I said, yeah, it's gonna be just fine. And he said, how do you know? And I said, because I just met Mitt Romney.
People were afraid. People were thinking that something terrible could happen. After 9/11, the way we looked at these events changed drastically. More so than any Olympic Games, the world was really watching this one. How was the United States gonna respond? Could they put on an Olympic Games?
It was worse than I'd expected. I thought the Salt Lake turnaround was just a public relations turnaround. Instead, it turned out to be a financial turnaround and a governmental turnaround.
He was not a figurehead. He was not only running this show, but he was out there speaking to the people and showing them through his words, through his actions, what the Olympics could mean to the United States.
When I was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis, both of us just dissolved in tears.
Probably the toughest time of my life. Was standing there with Ann as we hugged each other and the diagnosis came.
I was very, very ill. I don't know if people knew how sick I was. I was frightened, Mitt was frightened, but I needed him desperately.
Look, I'm happy in life as long as I've got my soulmate with me.
Mitt decided that he was going to honor heroes throughout the country and that the torch relay was gonna be all about heroes. And Mitt chose me as his hero. My life was in jeopardy, and I was like as vulnerable as a person could be, and I trust Mitt. I trust him with my life.
She's gorgeous, absolutely beautiful. You know, I can't explain love. I don't know why it happens. I don't know why it endures the way it does. You know, at the very beginning, I sat with her, chatted with her, put my arm around her, and, you know, something changed.
My 16th birthday party was when Mitt and I really became sort of an item. Mitt helped plan it, and it was just a sort of the beginning of our romance. 1968, he flew into the Detroit airport right before Christmas. Of course, his mother is like, got her arms open, and he runs right by her. And grabs me.
On the car ride home from the airport, I turned to Ann and said, I feel like I've never been away. And she said, I feel the same way.
So by the time we got home, we get out of the car and we tell everybody, well, we're getting married, like next week. We compromised and waited until March 21st.
Yes, sweet baby.
Sweet baby.
I could do okay when I hit the two.
My brother and I, Matt, fought a lot.
Three, not bad. Four, it got to be a little much.
Hello, Ben!
Oh my gosh. Very rambunctious.
Okay, I now want to put the water on the mud. Oh, here I am. Telling everybody what to do.
And then with the fifth one, and Craig was my most active child. He was a handful.
Craigie!
Hi. Oh, Craig, don't squirt me.
I remember my mom was always begging for us to be quiet. Just please, can I have quiet in this house?
We could bend a lot of rules and get in a lot of trouble. We could never, ever say anything bad about my mom.
I traveled a good deal in my early career. I would call Anne and I could hear the boys in the background and she might be a little exasperated. And I said, Anne, don't forget, what you're doing is more important than what I'm doing.
I hate to say it, but often I had more than five sons. I had six sons.
How you doing, Knuckle Snorts?
He was really playful.
You know.
Mitt would walk in the door after work, leave the briefcase at the door. That was it. Never thought about work again until he left in the morning.
We just felt like we were the most important thing in his life.
I went to Mom if I ever needed money, because he never went to Dad. He was way too cheap.
My dad didn't have the right bulb, so he replaced it just with whatever bulb he had. Problem is, it sticks out way too far and blinds you as you cook. So he just solved that with some tin foil and duct tape.
I've been poor. I've worked from the time I was 12. I know what poverty is. I've been up through it.
For Mitt, I think he idealized his father. He really was his hero.
In the summer, my dad used to pack up our family and take us to the great national parks. It was during those trips that I fell in love with America. Dad was born in Mexico. His parents and grandparents had moved to Mexico. They were refugees from a revolution. I remember Anne asking my dad, what was the most meaningful accomplishment of your life? And without hesitation, he said, the greatest accomplishment of my life is having raised you four kids. Like me, he fell in love young. Family for my mom and dad was everything. My dad worked for his dad. He was a drywall guy. Back then, they called it lath and plaster. He could put nails in his mouth and spit them out pointy end forward. I grew up watching my dad lead.
Look, I'm in public life today because I'm concerned about America. I'm concerned about what's happening to America.
If he felt some way about a particular issue, there was no question in your mind about how he felt. Friends called him the brick because he was immovable. He let me tag along in some very unusual settings.
What's the best car on the road?
Rambler.
I didn't realize he was giving me an experience that was more helpful from a leadership standpoint than anything I learned in school.
Staples, I think, is a good example of where Bain & Company can support the management of an excellent company.
What was special about Mitt is he understood what was behind the numbers. What's behind the numbers was great people.
Mitt Romney valued every employee. He made it a point to let us know that every employee was critical to the success of Staples.
Why would anybody want to save on envelopes and file folders? Mitt is a cheap son of a gun. And if he could save 50 cents on paper clips, he'd drive a mile to do it.
Mitt knows how to grow jobs, bring jobs back to this country. And if you ask me why, because I've seen him do it firsthand.
He was dealing with the fundamental problems that companies confront. He was dealing with them in a way that allowed them to grow, to add jobs, to build factories.
Wicked smart.
When I became governor of Massachusetts, I took the skills I'd learned in business and went to look at our state budget. We were about $3 billion out of balance.
I'll never forget the first cabinet meeting. The governor asked one of his assistants to bring out a list of campaign promises. Now, there were something like 44 campaign promises. The governor said, by the end of this administration, we're going to go right down this checklist and keep each and every promise that was made. And I said, he's different.
I actually cut spending dollars in Massachusetts, and we balanced our budget and went from a $3 billion budget gap in my first year to over $2 billion rainy day fund.
When he came into office, we were in fiscal crisis. When we came out, we were on much more solid footing.
His whole life has brought him to this point of being able to have the skills and the experience to be able to tackle something as difficult as this, as turning this country around.
Mitt Romney is in this race, I believe, not just for himself. He's in it to improve the lives of the American people.
He's an extraordinary chief executive officer. I know he understands the economy.
He's uniquely qualified to get our economy moving again.
Takes control.
It's not a stuffed shirt guy.
Charismatic.
He is rock solid,
an authentic leader.
His values are so strong.
He's a man of faith.
Extraordinary character.
He cares about the lives of those with voices that are unheard.
An amazing, humble man.
I think he has a great deal of pride and love for this country.
Finds a way of turning adversity into opportunity.
He knows he's one of the only guys that can do what it's going to take to turn this country around.
I will devote every waking hour of my energy to getting America strong again. That's what an American president has to do.
Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome the next president of the United States, Governor Mitt Romney.
Kill Mike too. Kill Mike too.
Want to cry, but tell him if I don't survive.
Thank you, Denver, Colorado. You guys are the best. What a welcome. Thank you. And thank you to Joe D for kicking things off for us tonight. And we have some special guests here tonight. As you know, I just want to go through a couple of names. You got some congressmen here. Congressman Mike Kaufman, Congressman Cory Gardner, Congressman Doug Lamborn, Congressman Scott Tipton. And also some candidates for U.S. Congress, one from right here, of course, Joe Coors in the 7th District. And from the 7th District, Kevin Lundberg, and from the 1st District, Danny Stroud. And by the way, Bob Beaupre, who got things started today, is his birthday. Happy birthday, Bob. And it's good to be here in the home of the Jaguars. Congratulations, you guys. What a beautiful place this is. Well, I'll tell you what, this has been an interesting week. The president was being interviewed, and I guess he said something a little unusual. He said, you know, you can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside. We're going to give him that chance on November 6th. And you know, now and then when I go to various rallies like this, there'll be a couple of people who will start chanting, four more years, four more years. That's fine. They can express their First Amendment right. But I usually follow up with asking these questions. Do you want four more years of 8% or higher unemployment?
No!
Do you want four more years with 23 million Americans struggling to find a good job?
No!
Do you want four more years where every single year median incomes go down? Do you want four more years where half the kids coming out of college can't find a college-level job?
No!
Look, it's very clear. We can't afford four more years like the last 4 years. That's why we're going to get change finally in Washington that the people of America deserve. Now, I happen to think that this election is going to be an election of a very clear choice of two very different paths for America. And on one hand, you have the president's choice, which is a choice of status quo, which is saying he's going to continue the policies of the last 4 years. He calls his campaign slogan, Forward. And I think forewarned is a better selection. And Because what he's promising is the things he's done before. He's promising another stimulus. He wants to do that. He wants to pick winners and losers with investments in various businesses like he did last time. He's promised he's going to raise taxes. He's done that before. He wants to do that again. And so these promises he's made, we don't have to guess what the results will be. We've seen the results. We don't like the results. That's why that man needs to get out of that office and let someone get there who will take America on a different course. You've heard what he said before. And now it's very clear he's out of ideas and he's out of excuses. And November will get him out of office. So we've got that work to do. And this is the state to do it. I'm counting on Colorado. This could be the state that takes it over the edge. This is the state that could get us the electoral votes we need to win this. Now I take a very different path. His choice is status quo. My choice and the path I would take is bold new ideas to deal with an economy that's very different than what we've experienced before. My choice will lead us in a path that creates 12 million new jobs and rising take-home pay. And people say, how are you going to do that? Let me tell you, five key steps. One, we have kind of an ace in the hole that came along to us because someone learned how to drill into the earth, not just vertically, but horizontally. And so they can tap into oil and gas, and so we have extraordinary resources in both of those sources of energy. And so my plan is to make sure we take full advantage of oil, gas, coal, nuclear, renewables, and get America, North American energy independence in 8 years. And we know how to do that. The president has cut in half the permits and licenses on federal land and federal waters. I will double those licenses and permits. I'll make sure we drill in the Outer Continental Shelf and drill in Alaska, and I'll bring in that pipeline from Canada and keep that oil from going to China. Number two, we have to make sure that trade works for us, and opening up new markets for trade in Latin America and around the world is a good thing for a nation like us that's highly productive. At the same time, we have to recognize that if there are nations that cheat on trade, we have to hold them accountable. China has cheated. I will stop them from cheating and stealing American jobs. Number three. We have to give our workers the skills they need for the jobs of today, but we also have to make sure that our young people get the skills they need for the jobs of tomorrow, and that means we cannot sit still with our schools performing nationwide in the bottom third or bottom quartile of world competition. This is the nation that invented public education. We have to be the nation that lifts up the quality of our education. We know how to do it. We know what the key is, and the key is this: put our kids and their parents and the teachers first, and put the teachers' union behind. So number one is energy. Number two is making sure that we have trade that works for us. Number three is getting the skills we need to succeed. And number four, if we're going to get entrepreneurs to start an enterprise, put people to work, or if we're going to have some big company decide to build a new factory and put more people to work, they're going to have to believe that we're not on the road to Greece. But this president, with trillion-dollar deficits, has put us on that road. And if I'm president, what I will do is I'll cut federal spending, I'll cap federal spending as a percentage of the economy, and I will finally get us on track to a balanced budget. And number five, I want to champion small business. I want to make it easier for people in small businesses to grow and expand and hire more people. This is a jobs plan. These five steps are designed to create more jobs. And small business is where two-thirds of the jobs were created over the last 15 years. And yet the president has a different plan. He plans on raising taxes on a million small businesses from 35% to 40%. That'll kill jobs. He also has a massive regulatory burden that keeps on crushing a lot of our small businesses. And then he has a very special idea, which is he wants to take away the rights of American workers to decide by secret ballot if they want a union or not. He wants these unions to be imposed on them. Look, my agenda is to do everything I can to help small business, to encourage small business, to allow it to grow and put more people to work. We do those things, we'll create 12 million jobs. Now I have to tell you, I've seen American entrepreneurship and innovation at work as I've gone across America and had a chance to meet a number of you at events like this. I've had the experience of meeting some entrepreneurs. They've been very impressive. I find people. I was with a woman who said to me that she had her own business. I said, "Well, how'd you get started?" She said, "Well, my husband lost his job and he took a class in upholstering." And she said, because I was the better business mind in the family, I started the company and hired him as my first employee. And then she went on to hire 39 more people as upholsterers. And so she has a leading upholstery business. She saw an opportunity and she built an enterprise that employs people. I met another guy. Yeah, and she built it. And she built it. That's exactly right. She built it. I met Sarah Fry from Illinois, by the way, and another woman entrepreneur, and she came to a big fundraising event of mine. I said, "You know, how did you begin your business?" She said, "Well, I began at age 16 selling pumpkins from the back of my pickup truck." She now sells more pumpkins and melons than any other organization in the United States of America. It's absolutely amazing. Entrepreneurs that she built it too, didn't she? Yeah, exactly right. Let me mention another one that I saw, Jim Leoto. Jim is from Central Illinois, and he graduated second in his high school class, second from the bottom, that is. And don't take too many lessons from this, young people, but he graduated from the second from the bottom, and he decided that college was not likely to be part of his future, so he went to his dad and said, "Can I get a loan from you? And if I can, we'll split the business 50-50. He wanted a food business of some kind, and his dad agreed. And then he went out and priced the equipment he wanted, a hamburger griddle, those rollers that heat up hot dogs, and, you know, the exhaust fan and all that. And by the time he priced it out, he realized he couldn't possibly pay for it with the money he had. So he concluded the only thing he could do with the kind of money he was able to borrow was to make sandwiches, because sandwiches don't take a lot of equipment. So he set up some stainless steel tables in a garage and made sandwiches and then delivered them to people at work. And now Jimmy John's has 1,500 restaurants and employs 60,000 people, and you're right, he built it. If we do those five things, because I know the entrepreneurial, innovative spirit is still alive and well in America, you're going to see this country come roaring back. I understand what it is that made America's economy work from the very beginning. The founders recognized something profound, inspired, wise, and that was that our rights came not from the king, but our rights came from God himself. And among... And among those rights, and you know them, among those rights were life and liberty and the pursuit of happiness. We would be free that we trip off that last phrase sometime without thinking about it very much, but we would be free in America to pursue happiness as we choose. We would not have a massive government taking more and more from us, telling us what kind of doctor we could have and what kind of insurance we must have. We would not have a government telling us that we had to join a union whether we wanted to vote for them or not. That's not what America was in their minds. Instead, we would have individuals pursuing their own dreams. This is a nation of dreamers, dreamers who came here, dreamers who still come here from other places legally, those who are already here. We build this country. We build this economy. This is what America is. This is what will keep us strong. And sometimes Sometimes I think our president and the people with him just don't understand the power of these entrepreneurs, of these dreamers, of a free enterprise system. They don't understand what it takes to get this economy going. They don't understand small business. I do, not because I studied it, but because I lived it. You have to be in business to understand how to create jobs. Now, there's one more degree in which there's a dramatic choice between us, and that relates to our role in the world. The president has a foreign policy that's been characterized as leading from behind. By the way, that's another word for being a follower. And he has in place some plans for our military that are consistent with that kind of vision. His plan is to cut our military by about $1 trillion over the next decade. And this is at a time when the world is not safer. The world continues to be a very dangerous place, as we learn time and time again. We have heavy hearts as we lost diplomats overseas in Libya. We have heavy hearts as we see our flag being torn and burned. And this is a challenging time as we look around the world. And so I believe we need to have a military that's so strong, no one would ever think of testing it. I do not want to be at the mercy of events. I want to make sure America can help shape events in the world. And for that to be the case, we're going to have to lead. I was lucky enough to be in Poland a few weeks ago, and I met a world hero, one of my heroes, Lech Walesa. And what a guy. I mean, you think about that. It's almost hard to imagine that the Soviet Union had come into his country, had executed some 20,000 leaders in the country. And despite that background, he, as a factory worker, a shipyard worker at the Gdansk shipyard, stood up and said no to the Soviet Union, said no. And others joined him. And he began a movement that changed Europe and changed the world. An extraordinary man. I came in to see him, and he said, "You've come from America. You must be tired. You sit. I'll talk. You listen." and so I did. I mean, well, Lech Walesa tells you to sit and listen. You do. And so I sat down, and he began to speak. And for about 15 minutes, he said this time and time again, "Where is American leadership? The world needs American leadership." He said America's the strongest nation, the only superpower on earth. And he'd talk about a region. He'd talk about the Middle East, or he'd talk about Iran, or he'd talk about the Asia. And he said, "Where is American leadership? We need American leadership. I am committed to American leadership, which includes..." Which starts, that American leadership starts with strong principles and values, a conviction that our rights do come from the Creator, and it continues with a strong economy, so strong that we can lift the American families, and we can also build a military so strong we will recognize it as the greatest ally peace has ever known. I will keep America strong. We will lead. We will lead in favor of freedom. Now I have something I need you to do. I can commit to you that with every ounce of my energy, when I become president of the United States, I will get America strong in our homes, in our economy, and in our military. And I need you to commit to do something. I need you to each find at least one person who voted for Barack Obama last time and convince... Oh, they're just fine. We need them to come vote for me this time. So I want you to find them and talk to them and ask them whether they can't vote in favor of someone who will bring real change and strengthen America again and bring back good jobs and rising incomes. And I'll do it. I need your help to do it, because this is the state that could decide it. And I want to tell you one more thing, and that is I get the chance on occasion to tell a story or two. And I saw that film that you watched of me and my family. It began with some video from the Olympics in 2002. And I wanted to share with you something I don't often do at a rally like this, but you've been here a long time, and this happens to be one of my favorite life experiences because it related to those Olympics. I had the occasion, as you know, to help organize the Olympic Winter Games in 2002. And at the closing ceremonies, Vice President Dick Cheney came. President Bush came for the opening. Vice President Cheney for the closing. And the vice president asked me to choose an American athlete to sit next to him to represent all the athletes that had performed in those games. And so I chose Derek Parra. Derek is Hispanic American, born in Los Angeles, and he's about 5'4". He was a rollerblader. His friend said to him, you know, if you ever want to get an Olympic medal, you're going to have to pick up another sport because they don't have rollerblading. And so Derek went to one of the local arenas that had ice there, skating club, and went out and skated, and sure enough, Derek was fast. And he worked like the Dickens and went out and competed, I presume, against the big guys in Michigan and Minnesota and Montana. And not Montana, they don't have as much, but maybe in Montana, I don't know. But all these guys are the big skating states, Wisconsin. And he beat them. And he became a member of the United States speed skating team. And so he came out to our games in Salt Lake City and skated his heart out. And I believe it was in the 5,000 meters, he got a silver medal. And then in the 1,500 meters, he got a gold medal. Fastest man in the world on ice. So I said, Derek, you come in and sit with the vice president and represent all our athletes. And as he was coming in to the box, I stopped him and I said, Derek, what was the most memorable experience for you in these Olympic Winter Games? And it wasn't the silver, and it wasn't the gold. He said it was being honored to carry in the American flag that had flown above the World Center on September 11, 2001 into the opening ceremonies. He was one of 8 athletes who was chosen by his peers to carry in this flag. It's about 8 feet by 12 feet. And as you can imagine, it's badly torn and burned, so you can't put it up a flagpole. You got to carry it horizontally. And he and these other athletes did. He said, as we had the flag waiting to come into the stadium, the announcer said, ladies and gentlemen, the flag that flew above the World Trade Center on September 11th is coming into the stadium. And he said he expected the audience to burst into cheers, but instead total silence, complete reverence. And he said, so we began marching the flag in, and they stopped in front of the choir, and they began performing the national anthem. And he said, Mitt, it was hard to hold on to my emotions as they were singing those words, and I was holding that flag. And then he said, the choir did something I hadn't expected. Now, I knew it was coming because as the guy in charge of the Olympics, I chose the version of the national anthem they sang. And I chose a version from the 1930s by Robert Shaw. And in this version, you repeat the last line as a reprise. And the sopranos go up an octave. And the orchestration is much greater. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free in the home of the brave. And he said, this time, Mitt, as those words were sung a second time, a gust of wind blew in the flag and lifted it in our hands. And he said, for me, it was as if the spirits of all those that had fought and died for American liberty had just blown in that flag. And he said, so the tears began running down my face. And as he told me that story, tears filled my eyes. We're a patriotic people. We love this country. We recognize it is an exceptional nation. This is a nation that needs a leader that will not just talk about unity, but that will live unity, that will bring our people together to help us overcome the challenges we have, to keep our homes strong, to help our schools become the best in the world again, to make sure that we have an economy that puts our people to work in the jobs they deserve, and that will keep our military strong. I will do that with every ounce of my energy. I need your help. We have got to stand together. We've got to work together. We're taking back America. We must keep this nation the hope of the earth. Thank you so very much. It's an honor to be with you. Thank you. We got to win this one. Thank you.
I'd ever seen in this front yard. As they handed me my glass,
excites me. It energizes me. I want to go out and tell my friends and neighbors, and we've been doing it. But I think as people get to know Mitt Romney more, they become more excited. Don't say that he is a real person.
Latino voters. Do you think that we need Latino voters to win this state?
They'll judge it like me.